To order, it is 7:00 PM. Diane, will you please call the roll?
Karen?
Oh, she is on her way. She just called and said she'll be here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Danette?
Yeah.
Barbara?
Here.
Patty?
Here.
Here.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome, everyone, to September 16, 2015, Niles Public Library District regular meeting. First thing on our agenda, we would need a motion for the Library Board of Trustees to approve A, the minutes of the Budget and Appropriations Public Hearing of August 19, 2015, the minutes of the Regular Board Meeting of August 19, 2015, the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $167,930.21, payroll expenses of $260,947.15, special reserve expenses of $23,518.73 for a total monthly expense of $452,396.09. The payment to Visio Graphic for the printing of the Fall Issue of Chapter 1, and the travel request for Sydney Rademacher, I'm sorry if I'm saying your name wrong, Mary Miller and Donna Black to attend the Illinois Library Association in Peoria, Illinois for October 21st through 24th, October 2015 for $2,500. Susan Lumpke to attend the American Association Midwinter Conference in Boston, Massachusetts for January 7th through 11th, 2016 for $1,800, and Susan Lumpke to attend the iLead project presentation in Springfield, Illinois on October 28th through the 29th, 2015 for $300.
So moved. Second.
We need a correction on the minutes, so from August 19th.
Okay.
If you go to page 5, the paragraph starting Ms. Ryan, it says Ms. Ryan stated that the board does require any public comment.
Is that the Budget Board meeting?
Oh, I'm sorry. No, minute Budget and Appropriation.
Okay, so we're catching that. It's the public hearing. You know how you read anything, your words just add in those.
I'd like to actually add some comments to the minutes, which seem to be missing on the regular board meeting. I don't have them with me, but I have prepared them at home, and I'd like to submit them. I didn't have enough time to get them ready. But I read through the minutes, and while we do say quite a few comments and facts, I think we're missing some others, and I'd like to share that with you. I could send it to Diane. You can certainly check your tape. Because I understand they're not verbatim, word for word, but there were some comments, I think. I know comments that I made and comments by some of the our taxpayers, and I think we just left out a few comments or a couple of their sentences, and I think what it did is it would give us a complete idea of what actually took place at the meeting and everyone's opinion. And if possible in the future, and it's on the agenda, I'd like to discuss the process of creating it. But that's later on.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
So while we approve the consent agenda, items A through E, with the exception of B and co-op B, to be approved, can I approve?
Okay, and then I also had one other question about the August 19th.
The regular,
yes, on page 3. We were talking about the budget for salary expenditures being raised $150,000 to cover any anticipated staff. No, we were having that debate, and then went with the $75,000 expenditure. Then it says they ask that we be notified before any jobs are listed. I know Karen made that statement. I just wanted to kind of get an idea of exactly what she meant by wanting to know about the jobs that are listed.
Actually, her comment was something to the...
Oh, you're here.
Go right ahead. She can talk to him.
Okay. I mean, did we want to actually, I mean, be able to spend the $75,000 at the jobs, or we want to actually...
Yeah, it's our call, actually, we just wanted to know before that $75,000 was actually spent, and to discuss it beforehand, and that it wouldn't be automatically spent without any other discussion.
Okay, so, see, maybe the job description, or is that maybe?
Yeah.
A little more clarity on that?
I think the process is also what we'd like to have a handle on. I believe that the hiring process is definitely handled through the director, but as the board, we are the authority on approving. So if it serves me correctly, boards usually approve a hiring, and then the start date is after a board meeting. So no one's usually hired by any public entity, they're approved by the board, then they begin. Ours is a little reverse from what I'm familiar with, so, I mean, aren't we the authority on this?
No, I think we hire the director, but we don't approve all the other...
I thought we approved all hires.
No.
It is actually in the policy right now, which is one of the things I wanted to discuss with you later. The way it is written in there, it is not the way it's done at any of the other libraries, except for Rockford. All of the other libraries, hiring is done strictly through the director. This library, this, we changed our policy a few years ago, so that the board started approving things that they previously had not been approving. So that's your perception, since that's been the whole time that you've been on the board, so naturally enough, you would feel that was correct. But I am proposing to the board that that officially be removed from the policy.
I think we need to consider control of money, remember, we're responsible for the budget.
But you set the budget already, so, and this is the piece where I was a little concerned that, you know, I was supposed to come back to the board before spending that money, since it's budgeted now, but I'm gonna do whatever the board, I have agreed to do that, so I'm not gonna spend it without it going to the board.
Okay, all right, so...
I'm glad you brought, there's more corrections on the regular board meeting, August 19th, page, I circled it, okay, nine, where it says resolution amending the bylaws. It said, trustee Durbin moved the library board to trustees adopt resolution 14-1, and then at the bottom, trustee Durbin seconded.
Yes, right.
And then the executive session started at 8:48, ended 9:23, open session began at 9:12.
You are a very good editor.
So we need whoever made the motion to consent to the amendment of the motion, which would approve the consent agenda items A through E, with the exception of B, and have B be removed to the next meeting.
I'm okay with that.
I'm sorry, can I ask, which one is the one that Carolyn has?
Where it starts resolution amending the bylaw on page nine. On the regular board.
Right there. Yeah, no, I understand that, but I guess I thought we were going back to approving the consent agenda. Is that what you're saying, Devin?
Yeah.
Okay, so...
There's a motion on the floor.
And I think you're suggesting that whoever made the motion, if they consent to changing the motion, the new motion should be that all the consent agenda items be approved, with the exception of which one? I forgot.
B.
Item B.
Okay, all right.
Right now, there's a motion that's been made and seconded approving the entire consent agenda, and a number of our trustees have an issues with item B, so...
A two, all right. Because here it was, Ms. Ryan stated that the board does require...
Yeah.
Well, which is then where that is.
And Carolyn has a number of changes she's gonna suggest.
Okay.
At the next meeting.
So then they'll be approved next month.
Okay.
Item B will be, assuming that motion to amend is approved, seconded, and passes.
So.
Who made it?
It was Barbara and then Patty second.
So do you?
I said, okay, yeah.
You second?
Yes, sir.
All right, so right now, what's before the board is approving the consent agenda items A through E with the exception of B.
So that's the actual motion now?
Correct.
Okay, so are all the discussion, anyone else have anything?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, just take the roll.
Okay, Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Chick?
Yes. And at this point, why don't we make a motion to move item three B to the next regular board meeting?
I'll make that motion, or to table it to the next meeting, maybe?
Yeah, to table to the next regular board meeting in October.
Anybody have a second?
Second.
Okay, so who moved?
I do.
Okay, so it's Karen? Second.
All right.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Are there any public comments? Then, did we want to go for our little walk now? Okay, so, we're just keeping our agenda open, our.
We just got to move the public meeting to where?
Well, first the children's department and then the lower level.
All right, we're just going to, Susan wants to show us the new digital media library. And so we'll just take a little walk.
Requested a preview, so.
Now we're going to go with the treasurer's report. Greg, do you want to review the financial reports?
Certainly. Page 34. Yeah, just a brief narrative on how we're doing 2 months into the new year. If you remember from past presentations, every month that passes, on average, if we're spending at an even rate, we spend about 8.3% of our budget. So after 2 months, we should have spent on average about 16.6% of our budget. But having said that, revenue for the month exceeded our budget expectations by about $350,000. We're still short of year-to-date expectations by $200,000, or about 7.4%. We expect to catch up over time, but the shortfall is due primarily to the way that the county collects and remits, and ultimately how residents pay their property taxes. So, whenever a resident pays their property taxes, it flows to the county then identifies it as an IELTS receipt and then remits a portion of it to the library. Regarding expenditures, salaries for the month are about $12,000 short of budget estimates, or about 4.7%, and $23,000 short of budget estimates, or 4.6% on the year. Library materials for the month are $19,000 under budget, or 31%. We're $6,000 over budget at the end of 2 months, or about 5%. It's due primarily to the payment of annual subscription fees for some of the library's database products. You pay for a year in advance, and those are typically lump sum payments. Library operating expenses, about $14,000 under budget, or 47% for the month, $22,000 or 37% year to date. This is due primarily to late billing of CCS charges for the first 2 months of the year. So we expect those charges to come in shortly. Runs about $7,000 a month or so, and we should be pretty close to the budget after that. General administrative expenses are just about even, about, you know, just under $1,000 under budget estimates, or 3% for the month, $11,000 under, or 21% year to date. And it's due primarily to slow spending of the legal, sorry Dennis, legal expense line.
That's a good thing.
And the consultant line items. Employee fringe benefits, about $7,500 on their budget, or 13.4%, $8,500 or 7.6% for the year. They, you know, when you run under for salaries, you typically run under for employee fringe benefits as well. Plus, employee fringe benefits are accounted for as they're being used. So, you know, we may have some employees that are hanging on to expenses prior to reimbursement, and just haven't submitted yet, or everybody might just be healthy. Utilities are about are within $1,000 of budgeted expense, both monthly and year to date, so we're doing well there. Our net surplus or deficit for the month, the net surplus is $1.3 million, which is $400,000 favorable to the budgeted net surplus of $882,000. $73,000 unfavorable, or 4.4% year to date, and it's being you know, driven primarily by the collection of property taxes. Anybody have any specific questions that you have for the next term at this point?
I have a very simple question. Salaries are short of budget, which means under budget.
Correct.
Okay.
And serious, my question would be, this will change because of heating and all that over the colder months too.
Yeah, so in terms of utilities, right now we're spending more on electricity than we are on gas, and then that situation will reverse as the temperatures outside get cooler.
Yeah, so that will.
Daylight savings.
Yes.
Hey, Rebecca.
Any other discussion?
The other thing, as long as I hear before, the other thing I want to mention is that we have to start looking at our property tax levy, which we generally finalize and pass in November. Dennis, it's due like the second or last Tuesday of December or something like that. So we generally have it on the docket for the November meeting as a final action. I don't have anything prepared, but you know, one of the things, you know, there's a few things that we have to be aware of. One is that, you know, there's continued talk in the press of freezing property taxes. We haven't been successful. The state hasn't been successful thus far in putting anything in place, but I'm not exactly sure if you know, the county might change its calendar or something to, you know, to accommodate that. We also are at a point where a lot of our special revenue fund balances are being exhausted. To date, well, since I've been here the last 2 years, we've only levied for Social Security, which runs about $230,000 a year or so. We've been in a position where we've had healthy fund balances in the audit fund, which runs $14,000 or $15,000 a year, and our liability insurance fund, which I believe is in the $30,000 range, unemployment compensation, which is about $20,000 or so, and a few others, you know, where we're finally getting down to the point where we're going to have a zero balance pretty soon. So we have to think about increasing those levies so that those funds stay solid. You know, in addition to, you know, looking at the activities of the library on a day-to-day basis and what it may take to operate something like the Creative Studio, the Wonderground, what kind of attention it's going to take from librarians to come in to use some of the equipment, such as the 3D printer that we just saw, the laser cutter. So, just a warning that, we have something more substantive, on the agenda for next time and with an eye towards final action in November.
I thought we moved money to the special reserve when we were given a list of things that we're going to need a roof, we're going to need this, and we moved all that money in there, so where'd that go?
So, it's still there. But there are three, we have three fund types, and maybe your confusion is my fault, because two of the three fund types sound an awful lot alike. You have the special revenue funds, and you have the special reserve fund. The special reserve fund is the fund which provides for the, I call it large projects around the library. Like you said, the roof, we're going to replace all the computers, and maybe buy a van to replace the one that we have. Right now, we have approximately $1.8 million, but those funds can only be used for those projects.
Right.
Okay, for those types of projects. The special revenue funds are funds that are funded, to use the same word too many times, by a special levy in the property taxes. So, to date, last 2 years, on a lot of the funds that I mentioned, the audit fund and the insurance funds and so forth, we've been levying a minimum amount like $1,000, just to kind of, keep the gates open, if you will. In the meantime, our expenses have been running much higher, so we're spending those balances down. In the year that I started, we started the year with about $1.1 million in the special revenue funds. We got it down to about $700,000, and at the end of this year, it should be around $300,000, okay? The interesting thing about the special revenue funds is it's not one big lump, but it's divided. And you can only spend those particular fund balances on very specific items. So I have, in the gross sense, $300,000 would pay for most of our special revenue fund expenditures, no problem. But I have about $260,000 in one particular fund, and then de minimis balances in the others. So by the end of the year, I expect most of those funds, maybe all but the one fund with over $200,000. I expect them all to be down to zero and needing money to stay solid. Does that help?
And those are black line, there's no gray area in them either, so.
No, we can't transfer out.
Transfer some of that 260 into another one, they're black and white.
Excuse me, so what's in our special revenue fund now?
Special revenue funds?
You said at the end of the year, we'll be at $300,000.
Well, we're at about $300,000.
Right, $300,000 now, not $700,000. We just ended the year, I thought you said, with $700,000.
No, we started last year with $700,000, and we just closed the year with something in the $300,000 range.
So in terms of the library as a whole, all we have on hand, cash and all, is $1.8 million in special reserves and $700,000 in special revenues. That's
no, we have about $8 million total.
Oh, I thought it was more than that. Okay, so we have $8 million and we need to raise the levy.
Well, let's take a look at the balance sheet, which is on, starts on page 18. Okay, and on page 18, you can see, we have about $8 million of cash in the general revenue fund. When you add the special reserve fund and the special revenue funds to it, the sum is about $10.5 million in total. We're a little heavy in cash right now because we've just collected a lot of our property taxes. Okay, As a matter of fact, the Illinois Fund's tax deposit account is $3.1 million. I don't plan to get any tax funds for September, which means that money will just be going out, none will be coming in. So those are our operating funds, basically. Those aren't our investment funds. If you take that out of the equation, we have about $5 million in our general fund and about $7 million overall. Financial planners, financial advisors, our auditors will tell you that it's always a good idea to operate with reserves. At $5 million, we're about 75%. I have to sit down and actually do the calculation. But we have about 75% of our expenditures in the bank. Okay, annual budget. That's generally a good place for us to be. It's really never a good idea to be like living hand to mouth.
I don't feel we are hand to mouth.
No, certainly not. We're in a great position.
What I'd like to know is why we would even fathom raising the levy and not consider reevaluating our budget and taking the time to actually review spending we don't follow any protocol in terms of usage. We don't learn from last year. We don't decide if, based on what we spent, maybe we could do something better. Based on what we need, we should choose a different route. We don't do anything to reevaluate any of our practices. We see what our dollar amount is and we just assume next year it's going up.
Yeah.
I mean, that is not a way to run anyone's finances. I wouldn't run my personal finances that way. I'm just so hard pressed to see that. We don't take the time to reevaluate anything we do. We just keep increasing and adding. We don't have a plan in place to think of raising the levy.
Yeah.
I can't imagine.
Yeah, I'm not advocating one way or the other. I don't believe you heard me advocate one way or the other. I did say that some specific funds are going to be out of money and we have to keep them solid.
And we should. And I
also would like to point out that there's a great deal of analysis that goes on across many different disciplines that you may or may not be aware of.
We've never been provided anything. We've never had anything brought to a budget meeting before. We didn't even have one this year. In some of the conversations I had with people who do make decisions in this library, it's very clear. If this was the number last year, I know I'll spend more money next year. So I'll raise it. There's no logic in that at all.
I certainly remember a discussion over the year about the special revenue funds in particular. And I remember the funds use balances used to be higher, and we either did levy or we levied very little in them, so as to deliberately spend them down, because we knew we didn't need them. But we also knew, we were worried about this, that eventually they're going to get to a point where we're going to have to start levying again because they're levying so low. So, I mean, what I know now is no surprise to me. I know that we've been told in the past that those special revenue funds had fairly high balances, we were deliberately spending them down, but that at some point we have to levy those funds again to pump them back up again. And so I think what you're saying is we're reaching that point with some of these funds. The special revenue funds are really pretty small part of the overall budget. And would that generally be true? I mean,
yes.
Social Security fund, and it's just, they're not huge amounts that go into those funds.
It's about, in total, it's about $350,000 annually.
And just to reiterate, Karen, it wasn't the administration telling us that they were going to have to levy. It was actually our auditor who told us that we had to levy down and then eventually levy up.
If we don't spend $1 million more this year than last year, we'd be in a much better position. Anyone will tell you to levy. Why would we do that? Why don't we take a good look at spending? We just don't do that. We have not reevaluated anything. We sat around with people during a board meeting. I didn't see any of these analyses that were done. This is what we did last year. This is our plan for next year. These are some shortfalls.
A great deal of the analysis that goes on on an ongoing basis. For example, when somebody leaves a position,
we analyze that position for whether it should remain that position, whether we need it, if there's some other way that we can handle it. When we put together the materials budget, for example, we look at the spending that happened in the previous year. We know that prices in some areas are going to be going up. We look at the circulation that goes along with it. We analyze for whether we perhaps are overspending in one area, perhaps our parent, our patrons are more interested in adult fiction than they are in adult nonfiction. So we'll adjust our levels that way. There's analysis that goes on at every step of the way, but we don't show you all of that because you should. I wouldn't normally think that a board would be interested in that level of detail.
I'm talking budget analysis. I'm not talking analysis like should we raise this, should we buy this, should we buy that. It's about looking at your spending.
I understand that. I mean, we do that all the time.
I'm not in any conversations we have over this table. Do we ever hear any reevaluation of spending? We had a 10% freeze, and all we heard was how horrible that was and how it devastated departments and programs. What programs were hurt by the $1 million that we ended up paying back to taxpayers? 10% cut, that's so minuscule. Most businesses run year to year with a 10% freeze to try not to overspend, to reevaluate spending. We obviously don't. We're going up $1 million. I don't understand the logic. So I'm not sure what kind of analysis we're talking about.
Well, let me bring on a couple of facts. The budget last year, total budget last year was $6,429,497.
It was 6,429,497.
The ordinance, the budget and appropriation ordinance that we just passed, ordinance 1505, was $6,498,076. It's an increase of $68,579. It's not a budget. So, and we would be under last year's budget, except for the fact that we added $75,000 to the salary line, just in case we needed the help in bringing the creative studio in the Wonder Ground into full operation.
So our salaries only went up $75,000 from last year?
Our salaries, on a budget basis, our salaries went up $45,414.
For the year, what, a 3% increase across the board?
No.
$45,000 is the raise for all these employees at 3%.
Well, there's a mix. There's, you know, there's, first of all, everybody doesn't get a raise on July 1st.
I know, but for the fiscal year, what would it cost us?
It's about $50,000 total.
For the fiscal year, it's only going to cost us $50,000.
Yeah,
approximately. But last month when we talked about the budgets, I asked you to clarify what was last year's budget. I showed 5.3, 5.8, some report that you showed us. I said, that's almost a million more. And you said you didn't have the figures in front of you. And now we're talking 6.4. So this is what I'm trying to say. This is probably not the best opportunity to discuss budgets in the middle of a board meeting because there is a lot of detail and there should be more information that we have. But I'm convinced we don't take the time to really reevaluate spending. We haven't done it for years. We've argued constantly over it. And I think at some point, somebody needs to consider tightening their belts instead of thinking of needing more money, how about needing to spend a little less? It just isn't a conversation we ever have or agree on.
Well, I just have to interject that. I feel like I'm getting the information that I want and need. Mm-hmm. But Carolyn, it sounds like you want something else. But I'm not sure exactly what it is you're looking for. What kind of
detail?
What type of detail? I mean, do you
probably
want to see
when we
how
met,
many books they
no,
purchased?
No, no, we've met the past 2 years and we've gone online. We've gone through the budget. We talked about what each line item consists of and what it involved in the department. So we had an idea of what was purchased and what was the purpose. And I mean, there's a lot more. I'm not looking for pennies and nickels and pencils. I don't at all mean that. Okay, there's a lot more to planning a budget than just spending money. And there's programs that we run here. There's how many patrons attend, how many don't. I mean, I hear about some of these fabulous programs. We have 40 people at one of the events you just mentioned. It was so crowded. But then there are times you come in the library and it's, you know, it's pretty sparse. There aren't that many people here. I mean, we need to take all this into consideration. And we don't have those kind of conversations. And everything for this transparency that we've been awarded for 2 years, it amazes me, you seem not very transparent, and that bothers me. Even the way we verbalize over this table at last week's, last month's meeting with all these taxpayers here, okay, that was not handled well at all. And I didn't care for the way we skated around our answers. You know, we need to, I just feel like we're not as forthcoming as our transparency awards claim we are. And I just think we need to rethink spending and try to think about cutting back as opposed to always increasing.
Can I just add, skating around our answers, I don't understand. We did not talk about anything with IMRF. It was never brought up, and that was their main focus.
We made it very clear in our responses, or whoever responded, that IMRF is not on the agenda.
Right.
That's true. IMRF, the passive, was not on the agenda. What was on the agenda was a change to the bylaws, which would allow us to pass IMRF without having to wait months and discuss and plan. It's the same thing. If we're not, if we have no intentions of passing IMRF, or we wouldn't dare want to rush through something so costly, what was the purpose of changing the bylaws, reverting them back, when the purpose of changing the bylaw to reflect that was to let us think about it, let the community come together and realize what a cost and impact it's going to have on them. So I felt it was rather deceptive.
Yeah, I think the majority of the board felt that we were going back to the way the board minutes had been before.
Why? It's really the reason.
And that the change that was made back in earlier this spring was unnecessary and inappropriate.
Why was it unnecessary?
It wasn't necessary.
To slow down a process of such a cost to the taxpayers.
Because whenever we've discussed IMRF in the past, I can only remember doing it once, but we did discuss it for months and months and months.
We didn't. And I was the chair. I was the chair of the benefits committee. Very few people showed up. Very little information. It was pulling teeth to get information for that committee. It was the biggest stalling tactic. Yes, I was here by myself many times talking to our business manager. Well, I'm talking about just 2 years ago, and then Morgan implemented that change because we needed to get information before we jumped on IMRF. And then all of a sudden now, I'm just saying, I don't understand what value it was to revert back when it gave us, it gave the taxpayers an opportunity for us to review and educate ourselves before we made a decision. To me, that was deceptive, especially when the gentlemen sitting there were concerned about IMRF being passed. And we kept saying, oh no, that's not why we're here. Well, of course that's not why we're here. But the fact of the matter is, we changed the bylaws so it can pass more quickly than slowly, which would impact them, and that was their concern.
And thank you for your opinion, but that's your opinion. And we had different votes across, and it was a majority vote.
Obviously, it is 5-2, often that's true, but I'm just saying, doesn't mean my opinion isn't valid. It's just minute, or the minority.
Well, I didn't vote to change the bylaws, so that's IMRF. That was my intent.
And mine neither. It was a change to keep the bylaws to be a generalized document and not have anything specific in it, which a bylaw should not.
To reiterate what Linda said at this meeting, she said we're going to take a good, long, hard look at all the options before we make any change. It's not that we're going to put it on the agenda in one meeting and pass it that same night.
So why would it have hurt to leave the bylaw?
Because I don't
It shouldn't have been in the bylaw. It should not have been.
Bylaw
in,
should
we were just undoing the damage that was done in the spring.
See, I don't know that it's damage. I think what you need is to have controls and balances, but we don't have any.
That's why we're all here, and we were all voted in by the community.
Well, that's why the community showed up last week.
With misinformation.
But I know IMRF is coming up real quick.
It is.
We will be meeting,
but I'm absolutely certain that we will be discussing the retirement benefit for staff. IMRF will be one of the things that ends up being discussed. It is not anything that could come up fast and just be passed forward. Just the process of starting it, we would be bringing in someone from IMRF, we'd be bringing in someone from ICMA, we would be bringing in anyone else that any of the board members suggested that we bring in. It would be a multi-month process at the very least, And every single time that it is discussed, and I have said this to you, and I have said it to my staff, I absolutely promise that every time it is going to be discussed, it will be clearly labeled on the agenda, because I have no intention of trying to hide anything.
Well, it's in your directive.
I am trying to be as clear and transparent as I possibly can.
And we also need another survey. We have to find out what the, we have to poll the staff again. We need to know everyone's opinions.
Well, first, we need to bring IMRF in.
We did that.
Oh, but we need to start now.
IMRF has changed.
Right.
So you start with them.
Well, we don't have to start with them.
And then can we just move on?
Right, okay. So, let's see, where are we? Director's report, Susan, not for the director's report, please.
Well, Greg led nicely into the first item that I have for you, which I mentioned in the director's report, which is that we have these two things that we keep talking about financially that are very confusing, special revenue and special reserve. And over the years, I have heard all of us confuse those two things in the course of a conversation. So I am proposing that we begin calling the special reserve, is that right? Special reserve fund, the capital projects fund. So that we get the word special.
Good idea.
This is a really good idea.
So that we have our.
Make it less confusing.
Yeah, because it confuses all of us.
Capital improvements?
Capital, whatever you guys would want.
Because that would be like for the roof and stuff like that.
Roof, that's capital.
Right, infrastructure type items.
Yeah, that makes sense that you'd call it something like that.
In the interest of clearer communication, I thought I would start doing that, but I did want to make sure that that was okay with you, because of course historically we call it something else. Is there any problem that you need to see with that?
If for the general purposes of our discussion, we call it capital project fund, that's okay. We're going to make transfers to that fund, the special reserve fund, it's a defined term and a defined the fund type.
Okay.
So if we're going to make a transfer into this, that fund, we're going to, the ordinance is going to say transfer to the special reserve.
Okay. All right, well, that's fine. And we can just refer to it amongst ourselves as capital reserve, and we can say special reserve.
Also known as slash.
Yes, exactly.
AKA.
Yeah.
That's great.
So just so that we're clear on it, but I don't.
But from a legal perspective, we're always going to call it special.
That's fine. That's fine.
Okay.
As you know, we have a member of our staff that is going to get an award at the Niles Night of Roses. I would heartily encourage board members to attend if that is something that you have decided that you think is appropriate for the library to be paying for. And you'll need to be letting Diane know within the next couple of weeks whether you're going to be doing that or not.
Okay, and what was the night of that again?
October 17th. And I'm excited about it. I think it's
very
fantastic publicity for the library, and Neil is such a wonderful, wonderful librarian and has done so much for those vets that I think that it'll be really a wonderful highlight for both that program and for the library and for Neil himself, though he does not want to be in the spotlight.
And it's October 17th?
October 17th. So please let Diane know if you would like us to sit at the library table and to buy us to get you a ticket. And then I just wanted to mention that we had our first Niles Arts and Culture Advisory Council meeting last month, and the library got a great deal of love at that meeting. They really are looking toward the library as a place that is already doing a great deal of art and cultural programming. And so they really highlighted some of the things we're already doing. They are very interested in promoting anything that we do and making sure that it's promoted in a variety of ways. And I just think it's going to be a great opportunity for the library, so I'm really pleased about that as an outlet for promoting all of the great things that go on here and making them more widely known. So that was very cool. And it's also great to hear what other things are going on in the village that we can be participating in. So that is great. I wanted to let you know that the managers and supervisors have been meeting to discuss creating sound zones for the library. We get, as you've probably seen in the patron comments, we get the occasional complaint that it's too loud in places, and the structure of the building does not allow for very much of the building to be very quiet, because that atrium going up, the sound goes right up that atrium, so you can call it a silent area at the top of the stairs, but it's not going to be a silent area. So we're trying to come up with a strategy where we designate the areas that we can keep silent as silent for the people that really like quiet spaces. So the three zones would be silent, meaning whispering, basically. Quiet, meaning you would be trying to talk at a low level and not disturbing other people. And then social. And so in the course of working on it, it's not completely final yet, but most of the main floor would be social, because that's the commons, the cafe, kids space. I think we all know most of kids space is going to be pretty social. And most of this floor up here is going to be quiet or silent, and then the floor in between is going to be mixed use. So when we get that finalized, I will come back to you just so you can see the map and get what you sense in. But we're trying to please a number of different kinds of people that are using the library in different ways.
It really does help.
Yeah.
And then you just have the signage there.
Right, and it's clearer to people.
It really does help to get the signage there.
Yeah.
And people will then find their spots.
Yes, and they will sort themselves.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
To find the difference between quiet and silent.
Oh yeah, it'll have to be spelled out pretty clearly. Yes. I'm thinking of silent as, well, it's color zoned, so it's like silent is going to be red, basically meaning stop talking. That's how I'm thinking of it. We'll see if it works out that way. It is tricky though, because if you put, you know, quiet here and social here, there's not like there's a wall between them. So it'll be a slightly fluid thing, and we will not be able to make everyone happy. But we'll try. So that is basically all I have in my director's report.
I just wanted to point out, I really liked your 1,000 books before kind of the IPB kick.
That's great.
Yeah, it's really fantastic.
That's why you go, right?
Correct.
The audit field work is starting on Monday.
They're working on it?
That is auditing what?
Our financial statements for the last fiscal year. They've been out since this past Monday, and they should wrap up tomorrow.
Is there a report on that then?
Yeah, we'll get audited financial statements found from the auditing firm, which will then file with the state, and of course, if you want to do a copy,
okay.
And then we'll post it on our website.
And the other thing I wanted to point out too, Susan, in your director report, for the explanation of the audiobooks and the purchasing of the ebooks, that's really key, because I think a lot of people don't understand that it costs libraries a lot more money than if you go to Barnes & Noble and purchase the same audio. It's not $10. Sometimes it could be $75. It depends on the audiobook.
It does.
It could really be extremely high. Sometimes it's even more.
Yeah.
So
I think patrons often think that you can save money.
Oh, absolutely.
E-books are available now, and it would seem rational, but unfortunately, that's not really the case. I've been dismayed.
Yeah.
And I've just been dismayed that, you know, you can only pick up one book at a time. You know, it's not unlimited use of that book, which would be certainly technologically quite possible, were it not for the restrictions of publishers.
Right. Yeah, it's taken years to get the publishers to be willing to sell to the libraries at all, because they have this way of trying to sell individual copies to everybody, to have, you know, each member of a family getting a copy of the new Harry Potter on their tablet. So, we've been up against a changing market, but it has definitely improved, but it's definitely, even though it's counterintuitive, being electronic is not cheaper by and large.
Maybe you could consider putting a blurb like that in the newsletter that goes
sure,
out.
Sure, certainly. Certainly. Yes, and our blog on our website has been getting a lot more attention lately, so we can put a piece up there as well.
I think that's the document that probably most people in the village really
have. No, I think you're right.
Yeah, because even when I had came and met the staff one day, that was one thing, even though I'm a librarian myself. It just was an aha moment for me, because thinking, you know, in the public sector, you have to have that one title be in a large print, an ebook, an audiobook, a different language. I mean, we have all different types of formats that we have to purchase one same title. So when you look at a book budget and think, oh my gosh, it's really a large book budget, it's not necessarily as big as other books, because we have to buy that one title in all those different formats to meet, you know, all the community's needs. So just just for everyone to keep that in mind, and I think that'd be a really great idea.
Sure.
Put that in there. Because I think a lot of people forget that.
Yeah.
You know, that wine title could cost us hundreds of dollars by the time you buy each wine app.
Yes. Any more questions? Communications. I just wanted to point out to you in your packet that we got a very nice letter from Mayor Shabillo thanking us for allowing them to borrow some of our parking places when they were repaving their parking lot. That was very nice. And then you have the letter from the chamber designating Neil as the public servant of the year.
Okay, and the committee reports. Building and grounds. If I remember correctly, Barb, are you the only one on our building and grounds?
I think there are three people. I think Karen and
I said I should do it.
Okay, three of the building and grounds. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I'm not sure, Susan, maybe you can answer. Would you like to meet with you just to talk? Should we have a
I think it's probably a good time to have that because there are a number of things that Dave and Greg have been working on, and so we can kind of get you up to date on the current state of the building and anything that we consider.
So maybe you want to possibly email Karen, Barb, and Gabby, and then possibly get a date, and we can just start just a little discussion on some
Absolutely.
Ideas that you have.
Absolutely.
Friendly reminder, you know, you have.
Yes. And just back into my mind too, Carolyn and Tim, I believe I had you on the technology committee.
Correct.
And I was talking with Greg and Susan, and for a temporary piece, I'd like to disband the committee. Just because if they ever just for you know a few months possibly, because otherwise we're going to have to have a actual formal meeting, and if they just want to have a discussion with both of you, we have to have you know a meeting, and this way they can talk with both of you without having a formal agenda meeting for a few months, so then you can actually have some community members, some staff members, the admin, and have a discussion on all the new technology that they have, and then we'll put the committee back in place, so that it kind of just opens up our time so that they can actually talk
sure.
with you.
So the question is, there won't be any technology discussions or purchases for the next several months?
But the technology committee wouldn't be doing the purchasing or okaying the purchasing. It's really the technology committee was intended to be the experts on technology for the board, for proposals that would come to the board, so you could kind of help explain
right.
to the board. So this way, we can, right now, the way it is, literally, I cannot meet with the two of you because you're a committee. And so, like, you two could not come to my office at the same time and talk to me because it would be majority of the board.
Yeah, right. Why would we want to come to just talk to you?
Well, you had requested a meeting to sit down with and find out the IT system and get more information about it. So right now we can't do that without that being a formal public meeting.
Oh, I hope you would provide us with all that information. And then
we will provide you. Yeah, that's what we are now going to provide you with all that information. But by disbanding the committee, we can do it at your convenience and our convenience and not have it be a publicly called meeting.
So what's the plan for this committee since we're going to disband it?
Well, actually, we're looking at is being a more transparent because we would like some staff members included, we like the admin included, we like community members included.
Well, isn't that the plan? Aren't we supposed to just have
but if we want to do that a few months down the road after we've got you guys up
on
speed.
Board and with all the
knowledge,
right?
Yeah, but how much? I mean, it's been 2 months. We haven't gotten any knowledge from you, no information. How much longer will it?
Because I couldn't give that to you without calling a public meeting. And we were, you know, we just had a audit of our IT systems last week. We have not gotten the report on that back yet. So there really wasn't anything to say to you at that point. But now we, you know, we would like to meet with you.
Well, this makes us feel like we're going to move forward.
Yeah.
And we'll be able to do it in a quicker fashion.
At some point moving forward, will we ever get information about the technology
yes.
in the library? And if you have a vision in place, I mean, That's quite a bit of reading we've been doing on our own.
Oh, I don't want to read that.
Why?
They're as dull as dirt.
I see, I don't think, but anyway, so what's the plan? We'll disband.
The plan is that Greg and I will make plan with you and Tim to get together so that we can start explaining the things that are our current setup and where we're moving.
You and Greg, will we have any of the IT people there? I mean, are you two the tech people?
Greg oversees IT, so it would be up to him whether he wanted to call some of his staff for that meeting.
Oh, I'm sorry, I've never actually talked to Greg before about IT, more just the business manager.
Yeah.
So he's going to, so you're the person that's going to tell us what your plan is.
Yeah, so I'll supply you copies of the audit that we get, which will describe in detail what the topography of the network topography looks like. You know, how many users we have, and what kind of programs we're running, and how complex it is.
Do you have a plan for the committee, though? I mean, I thought the committee was going to be formed to decide what you wanted to do in the future, like what's your...
Well, when Linda started as board, well, Linda started as board president, I gave her a list of the potential board committees, and there were about 8 of them. And Buildings and Grounds was one, Technology was kind of in the lower level, and I had that as 2 potential committees. One version of that committee would be a committee of the board. The other version of it would be a committee that included members of the public, members of the staff. And so we aren't prepared right now to move on that second version of that, and that's what I did not make clear enough to Linda, is I can't, we aren't to the point where we would want to be pulling members of the public in yet. We want to work with board members first.
And they want to educate you, which then will educate us.
Right, so you will be the experts for the board on these things.
When it might start?
Well, we could now that she's been in the committee, now it can start.
Okay, so when would we like to schedule?
We can email that.
Yeah, I'll email Barbara, Buildings and Grounds dates, and I will email the 2 of you Technology dates, all right?
So there is no Technology committee?
That is now disbanded.
Correct. Disbanded.
Do we have to vote on it?
No, it's...
No, because it's my appointment.
Yes. See, there's something with being president.
Okay, liaison reports, Friends of the Library.
Yes, we just had a meeting Monday, and we've covered quite a bit. There were 4 suggestions, actually. One of the requests, this was from Susan, it was to replace 450 travel books, which I guess are outdated and probably in very poor condition. The cost was going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $4,500. There was discussion amongst the members. They felt that they needed some type of detail and information explaining why these 450. At that time, Susan explained that she receives her information from her librarian, who's an expert in this field, and it's not, Susan doesn't question her. This is what she gave us. So most of the members felt we would prefer to see some information or just provide them with some detail so they can move on this. So that was one of the items. There was also a request for a bus to take patrons to the Wakanda area for a Shakespeare traveling event, I think, if that's correct. I'm not sure when that's happening, but Friends are interested in doing that, and their suggestion was maybe we have a sign-up sheet so we could at least be assured people would come rather than have a bus and not be sure people would show and then charge some sort of a fee, which they're still working on. Another option was...
Is it still for the Friends or is it for...
No, it's for anyone, all the library patrons. No, Friends pays the bill. Friends were asked to pay these 4 items. That's who the Friends group is. And then there was also a request for some carts. Apparently, the Friends books could do some more public shelving and some shelving in the back just to work on their display, and I guess was feeling from other departments. So it would be nice if they could replace them. I think that one was voted on in the past. It's about $3,200. And then there was...
That's from the Friends fund.
From the Friends, yeah, this is all Friends. And then there was some discussion about, we have quite a few incredible volunteers, and they were discussing them. And that was about it.
Yep.
How many friends are there?
Friends, members.
Eight, yes.
Oh, I don't know, I just.
Oh, it's.
Yeah.
It's like eight or more.
Yeah.
It's a small group.
And that was our little get-together.
Is there any discussion there about increasing the membership? Probably next time.
I don't know.
No.
You just, you have to pay a fee to become a friend.
Be a member or something.
You know, I used to be a friend, and I paid it one time, and then nobody asked me to re-up, and I just sort of forgot about it. So I don't know that the friends are really good at trying to get people to re-up, and they just.
The friendship.
Well, I'll be honest with you, I just realized I'm not in some email group, so they went somewhere, and I saw Susan, I said, so did they end up going? And she said, oh, yeah, and I said, I never heard that it was a go.
I had to pay my dues to get on that list.
So, it was, yeah, I think there, so now I'm on an email list, so I'll have more information. Yeah, it's kind, maybe it's just still in some development.
Very current, getting numbers or keeping them.
Okay.
Are we allowed to be on in the friends? Was that a conflict of interest?
Well, it was a rough, really, for the life.
What are your, you know?
Twenty, fifteen for seniors and 20.
Okay. So by all means, phone rents.
Do they have an application or something, maybe next meeting?
Oh, sure, I could bring some, pass them around the table.
Seems to be like.
Well, I could email all of you.
Yeah, they could maybe double their numbers.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I mean, how could we vote and then approve what we, what you guys want? I don't know, it just seems like a conflict.
Oh, that could be. Since I'm only one person.
And they're spending their own money.
They're just spending their own funds.
Okay, so it is, isn't it, it's not, okay.
Oh, so you'd increase the numbers, and then when it's time to vote, it would be beneficial to the library. Well, actually, no, it's up to Chris, yeah.
Sometimes the friends will vote to donate something to the library, correct?
Yes, yeah.
So, you know, I suppose.
All right. Okay, legislative reports and rails reports?
Rails, I have a meeting tomorrow to get an update.
Okay, secretary's report, Barbara?
A certified copy of ordinance 15-05, an ordinance provided for budget and appropriations of the Niles Public Library District, Cook County, Illinois, for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015, and ending June 30th, 2016, was filed with the Cook County Clerk on August 20th, 2015. The ordinance was published in the Niles Herald Spectator on Thursday, September 3rd, 2015. B, a certified copy of the report of receipts and expenditures for the Niles Public Library District for the 6 months ending June 30th, 2015, was filed with the Cook County Clerk on August 28th, 2015. And C, a certified copy of the report of the Statement of Operations for the Niles Public Library District for the 12 months ending June 30th, 2015, will be filed with the Cook County Clerk upon receipt of the certificate of publication. The Statement of Operations was published in the Niles Herald Spectator on September 3rd, 2015.
Okay, new business, introduction of Library Director's Recommendation Policy Manual Changes.
Yes, I found in reading through the bylaws, it is part of my job to make recommendations to the board about your policies. As you know, you are in charge of policies, but I'm supposed to be making recommendations to you about amending policies and suggesting new policies when there's a need. So in this packet, you'll find, I pulled out the pages, for the most part, that have changes that I am suggesting. I'm not gonna walk you through every single one of them tonight. I wanted you to get a first glimpse of them and then come back to them next month. But, so we have, like, in the bylaws, some of it is just cleaning up. So in the bylaws, most of that is just cleaning up activity.
but I am suggesting a change to the bylaws that you add the phrase of, it's something to explain what the process is for changing the bylaws, because obviously that was the source of some conflict, and it would be good to get that ironed out. The suggestion that I'm making is to say, change it under miscellaneous.
What page is the page?
No, my copy does not have the pages. It's the last page of the bylaws piece, so it's about four pages in. Under miscellaneous, point 11.
Section 3.
It's highlighted. So the part I'm suggesting that you add, changes to the bylaws may only be made in a regular meeting of the Board of Trustees with five or more trustees voting in favor of the changes. So I'm recommending that. And if you continue to the administrative and services policies, page 1, I have added a point concerning adults, strange adults that might be in the kid space area. I don't want to set it up so that they're not allowed in kid space, but I do want to set up a rule saying to maintain a safe environment, adult visitors to the youth services department who are unaccompanied by a child may be approached and questioned about the purpose of their visit. Visitors who are not actively using resources specific to the youth services department may be asked to leave. And that's to create a safe space for kids.
You should add teens too.
Well, I considered that, and I certainly could do that. I could do that.
Is it more likely teens will be there by themselves?
Teens quite often are there by themselves, but we don't want adults there.
The reason I'm saying this is I was looking for something in the teen area one time, and the librarian came over and just asked me if I could needed help.
Yes.
Clearly, she was wondering why, big lump guy like me was hanging out in the teen area. Which is a great thing.
This is sort of more just codifying what they actually do, which is they do, they do try to make sure that anybody that is in kid space is supposed to be there.
Right, because it could just be a teacher there looking at the.
Absolutely, and that's why it's phrased as may.
Right, I mean, there are reasons why adults can be there without accompanying, however.
This next point is the one that we have next to talk about in more depth.
Susan, I don't really know where we are.
We're on page 1, 3.02, library rules.
It's in the bylaws.
It's past the bylaws, it's administrative.
It's past this page.
And I know that some of the page numbers down a little.
Oh, yeah, now it's page 1.
All right, so that's library rules. We're going to return to this other point about the library's place of business. But to continue. That's next on the agenda, but I'd like to quickly go through this, my suggested changes. Most of these are just tweaking.
But you've got 2 sixes here.
Correct, and I'm thinking that you may be getting rid of the second six. We can adjust that. Page 5 is another just cleaning up. We do not any longer have bulletin boards. We have slat wall displays. Most of these are cosmetic. On page 8, where it says smoking is prohibited in all library facilities and grounds. And this is part of the meeting and study rooms policy. However, that conflicts with the separate smoking policy. So the smoking policy on page 12 says that you can't smoke within 15 feet of a door, window, or intake ventilation system. Here it says smoking is prohibited in all library facilities and grounds. So those two things don't match, we need to bring them together. So that is a board decision. You guys can decide what you want to do, but I would like to get that.
Is that a board decision, or is that like some state law?
The 15 feet part is the law. You could extend it further than that to have it be a non-smoking campus. And I don't know how.
But we can decide no smoking, and we're not against some state law. We can decide, and we won't be in violation of whatever the state is.
Right. The law is the 15. It has to be 15 feet away. It is up to you whether you want me to strike this from this policy that it's prohibited in all library facilities and grounds, and just leave your smoking policy as it stands. Your call.
15 feet from the door.
Do we want to go around and just?
Well, you can maybe discuss it at the next meeting. I just wanted to kind of highlight.
Okay.
More. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. She's so right. Then at the bottom of the page, they have a couple points here that I don't see a point to. So I just lined them out. I don't see any reason to be restricting the meeting room. Then on page 9, they left out the study room in the kids' space department, so I added that. Page 11, there are 2 gift and donation policies in the manual. I thought that was also mysterious. So I I'm recommending that we take this version, which is a very short list, basically, and combine it with the longer, more detailed one that Dennis is from probably prepared, that goes into naming rights and things like that. So I'm proposing that we get rid of this one and add it to the other one.
Oh, the 3.29 and the 3.16.
Are both gift and donation policies. So I'm just trying to clean it up here, basically.
Would you have cleaned up the padlets?
I'm trying.
Wow.
All right. So I have added that to 3.29 at the beginning, because I still want to retain it, because I think it's very clear and direct for staff, for them to be able to look and be able to answer patrons quickly. So that's a change. And then that policy, I just left the rest of that policy in case you wanted to see the rest of it. It is several pages. Freedom of Information Act policy, page 23. There is a section of it that summarized some information that was correct at the time. It's this part here. But no longer is it. I prefer not to have things in the policies that would have to be constantly updated. And so most of this information is on our website, and that's where we currently send people now. So I would recommend just striking all of that from the FOIA policy. We'll hear from Dennis if he disagrees. Then moving on to the personnel policy part of the manual, page 26. This is the one that I mentioned earlier, where I would like to do a little bit of clarifying of our goals. And so we need to discuss this.
Yes, ma'am. The numbers are sort of cut off on the column.
Yeah, Diane told me that. I should have had Diane do it to begin with. Whether it's right, yes, yes.
4.02 appointment in the upper right-hand corner.
Correct. So I recommend that you strike this first paragraph here. Openings occur upon the resignation or termination of an employee and the intent of the board to fill the position or upon the creation of a new position by the Board of Trustees. I believe this is in conflict with the library director's role being in charge of staffing. It also theoretically means that every time I wanted to list a job, I'd have to ask you first before listing it, then list it, then try to hire it, then come back to you later on in this policy and get you to approve it, then send out the letter trying to hire someone, by which time I may have lost whoever it was that I wanted to hire.
I'm not sure that's a problem.
Well, you guys will have to, I'm giving it to you this month so you can talk about it and think about what you want to say. So next month there will be a chance for discussing all these in more detail, but you know, I realize that not everybody's going to agree with that. I feel strongly that I don't want to have my hands tied when it comes to hiring. And Dennis has said it's the director's job to do the hiring. And then again, we have a specific firm named in this policy. I don't want to have a specific firm being named because we may at any time want to change firms.
Or they make other business.
Or, yeah, exactly. Okay, so those all have to do with the things we mentioned. On the sick leave policy, page 28, 4.06, on 24, it's a rule that people in their first days at the library are not allowed to take. They can accrue their sick time, but they can't take it. I think that's crazy. I think if somebody is sick, I don't want them here. So I would rather have it stated that they need approval from the director to be able to take that time, but you know, I don't want.
Is it sick time?
Sick time. Yeah.
I think I'm lost. Point, the vacation.
I think you're the day. It should
four
be a page.
Point six.
There you go. Okay.
Okay. So,
yeah. And then I just rearranged the rest of this a little bit because the sentence about the library director may waive the certification was at the end of the second paragraph, and that.
Can I just ask for a quick clarification?
Absolutely.
What is it about sick leave? Are we talking about like a whole year's worth of sick days? They don't take it when it's approved, they take it ahead of time.
No, this is, nobody can take a sick day that they don't have. That line I'm having stand. It's just that right now, the way it stood was, although eligible employees accrue sick pay credit during the training period, which is the first 90 days of employment, they can't take that sick pay. No sick pay with leave is allowed during that period. I don't want people coming to work sick. I would much rather they took their sick
pay. I think you could take the day off, but you don't pay for it because you haven't earned it.
No, it means they can't use the time that they have earned because they're in their 90 days.
Oh, I got you.
So, right, but they do accrue,
they're
7.5 hours per month.
Correct.
Which is in the
because if they were like, oh, you're going to take the money back from paying them anyway, so I think that's just a safety net, that 90 days, I think that's why people used to do
that. No, they accrued it.
Well, it used to be a 6-month
period. But you don't get paid for 6 months.
Yeah.
But this way, after a month, some cultures say, they actually do have the time.
They do have the time, and I would much prefer them to stay home.
If you approve it, then they can take it.
Right.
Susan?
Yes, ma'am.
Item five here, it says if an employee is on sick leave for 3 or more consecutive days, I'm thinking we should make it for more than 3 days, because if somebody's got the flu, they're not gonna go to the doctor, they're gonna die in their own bed. You know what I mean? They're not gonna feel like.
Why should we send them to the doctor?
Well, I have it's been like that for a while, but that's why I moved the part about the library director at his or her discretion may waive that. So I can just say, you know, you've got the flu, I understand, you don't have to go to the doctor.
Okay.
So.
I know in our policy, we have 3 days.
Yeah.
We have to show.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but I mean, I think that might be unrealistic, because people won't always go to the doctor when they have the flu. They just kind of.
It depends.
It's actually kind of a good policy to place, in my opinion.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with Linda.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just.
We have more experience.
Being in charge of many people.
Well, it keeps people a little more honest, if they know they have to get a doctor, so.
It's actually. And usually they can have a doctor even just fax it to us.
Exactly.
It works out.
Right.
But we can have a discussion.
The 4.08 vacation allowances. And this came up because when I was looking at this policy, Greg, as the policy currently stands, is actually not on here. And he has plans this year, he needs extra vacation, and it seemed very unreasonable to me that he not have 4 weeks of vacation. So I have added a line. The way it was before, there was the director and the assistant directors were not on this list at all. It was librarians and department heads, all other full-time employees. The director and assistant director were not on the list at all. I think, you know, it doesn't matter to me. I have my 4 weeks of vacation. Cindy's got her 4 weeks of vacation. I think Greg ought to also be able to have 4 weeks of vacation.
Absolutely.
As a negotiating point, I think. But somebody at that level should just honor
what did you have before?
Technically, he'd be all other full-time employees, and he'd only have two.
How do you determine when he did? Oh, 3 weeks, one of your eyes.
Depending on years.
That is what I would like to add to the policy, so that Greg can go ahead and have 4 weeks. And people in the future. I mean, if I were to negotiate to come into this job and I hadn't had the 4 weeks, that would have been a negotiating point for me. And then point F, it's just a correction because our forms used to call for the library director to sign, and there are no more forms like that anymore. The leave of absence without pay, I have changed, so it's page 30 and 31. I would like to change it so that somebody who has had a baby can take sick leave for that. That actually matches our current practice. We certainly, you know, somebody that's just had a baby, in my view, is entitled to have their leave part be paid out of sick leave if they had it. And the way it's worded right now, you wouldn't be taking sick leave. So I just wanted to move A from the first section where it's vacation or personal leave and make it sick leave, vacation leave, and personal leave. So it's just cleaning up to match our current practice. And that's not a conflict with the law. The law allowed us to write it this way, but I think people, somebody that's just had a baby certainly ought to be able to take sick leave. Moving to page 32, attendance at professional meetings. Point four, there's the line, in the years that PLA holds a conference, attendance at ALA will not be granted unless it is held in Chicago. I think that ought to be up to me. You know, I think in general I would be encouraging people to go to PLA rather than ALA, but I'm not. You know, if somebody has a good reason, I would certainly listen to it. So I don't think that belongs in the policy. In point six, it says that if a library staff member is invited to serve on a committee, like for example the site work committee that I'm on for children's nonfiction, they must have board approval before making the commitment. I don't think that's reasonable. I mean, you can't tell me I can't take a commitment. So, but I do want to make it clear to the person taking that commitment on that we're not promising that the library will pay for them to go.
Is their voice decision or the library?
It's their own decision.
Pay them. Is it a board decision?
That would be, that's actually covered in the next. That is, you have, yes, I am recommending that that decision be mine rather than the board. The board is in charge of setting that budget.
approval item.
Well, you know, and just one comment, because I know we're rushing through this rather quickly. What we're doing here is we're deciding the board has no control over spending. And I think that's why we're here. We are here to scrutinize the way we spend money. I mean, if you take all of that away from us, then why are we meeting? I mean, the tax dollars, we had levels on how much to spend. We ask that you bring things to the board so we could review it, because since nobody really keeps a tab on spending and we just keep increasing it, that's why the board's part of this. We're responsible to the taxpayers for spending. You're managing this library, that's true. But you're not in a position to decide that you could spend all the money you want. Somebody needs to reevaluate that. You, by all means, can decide what you want.
Checks and balances on every single month.
Checks and balances on what?
On every single, we've got to see every single expenditure that they...
We get to see things after the fact. We can't discuss it.
And we can always question it.
We can question it, but we can't control spending. There's a difference. I mean, everybody in this library can go to California, but what makes you think we can afford it?
Because we have a line item, they wouldn't be able to go up that budget, line item.
That's the other thing.
It's called micromanaging.
It's not micromanaging. We didn't even decide not to spend one penny. How about we reevaluate it? We're talking about not getting the revenues that we anticipated in the past, and yet let's just keep going here and there without even conferring with the board. It sounds illogical. I mean, that's what we're doing. We're stripping the board of all its authority and giving it all to the director. And that's how it used to be, and the budget was out of control. That's when this one found big Christmas, $5,000 Christmas party, and in the trustee's budget, not a line item. We didn't know anything about it. That's what I'm saying. We didn't have the opportunity to review information.
When it was $5,000, the board members came to that party.
No, we did not come. We weren't even invited to that. We weren't. I don't know what board members came.
This would have been in the past then. If the board did approve the Christmas party.
We did not approve it to that extent. And that was what made everyone angry. We hadn't even traveled that year, and the board was, the charge was over $5,000 or some ridiculous amount. We would never.
Okay. Well, I will get those correct figures, because I can't have false information.
It's not false. It may even be higher. My point is, we've already experienced so many incorrect figures, so many hidden figures, and now you're stripping the board of any responsibility in term or authority to decide how to spend money. It's like now everything's hidden.
I don't believe there's anything hidden within our budget.
Believe me, the way we review a budget here, it's hidden.
Oh my God.
Can I ask a question? We're not voting on anything.
Correct.
Now. You're
no,
just
no,
giving
no.
us this to look at, then we can discuss it next month.
Correct.
And in order to change something like the last time, don't we have to discuss it for like 2 or 3 months?
Anyway? No, absolutely not.
Okay.
You'll
okay.
Vote next
I'm sorry. Month. I'm just asking because for my gentleman. No. Okay.
No. Right now we're just having a discussion.
Okay. Well, thank you.
So in policy 4.15, electronic communications use policy, there are a few things in it that I think are a little bit old-fashioned when internet bandwidth was much tighter, so I'd like to eliminate some of those. For one thing, it says the computer systems belongs to the library district and may only be used for business purposes. I think that's a little stretching. On the next page, under unacceptable use, in two places it refers to not being able to look at videos or picture files because of restricted space. Again, that is not an issue any longer, so I'd like to strike those. Certainly everybody looks at YouTube when they're at lunch. Page 37, it has the line, using the internet to access personal email accounts with personal email providers is not permitted, so that means I can't check my Gmail account from work. I think that's kind of silly. So I recommend to strike that. And those are my recommended changes.
I just have a quick question about your email use. Isn't there already some sort of law that says, or is it just a given, if you review your personal email at work, that your employer has a right to? Isn't
there that is in one of the policies.
So
the
even if you take this out, I think you can view your email, but just understand your employer.
Right.
Good. Okay.
Yeah, that's the no expectation of privacy.
You're
okay.
Your employer
could access all that information.
Not really.
if you were accessing your email off the internet, they would, the employer, anything you put on your PC, your employer would be able to get to.
Right.
If you were using your PC as a communications device going to your email, they wouldn't have any way to do it.
I'm saying it opens up, it opens up an opportunity for your employer to get.
They know you're accessing.
Yeah, yes, but, you know, if.
Can I ask one question? In the beginning, somewhere in the beginning of the bylaws, you're changing, only a part of it. The bylaws may only be made at a regular meeting of the Board of Trustees with five or more trustees voting in favor of the change. What was it before?
It wasn't specified, it wasn't specified at all. There was nothing in here saying.
Oh, it wasn't included?
There was nothing saying what the mechanism was for changing the bylaws, and I decided it would be good to be.
The majority of the board could change the bylaws.
What's considered the majority? Because it says five or more.
Majority is, out of seven is four.
So we would change a bylaw and it wouldn't even have to be unanimous?
Correct. Currently, your bylaws provide for that.
Provide for, it being four.
For majority approval to change the bylaw.
So we can change a bylaw with just the majority, that's what this says.
Well, I mean, you guys could make it that you want it to be unanimous, but.
Used to be four, now it would be five.
Right, so it's more of a super majority.
It's more strange.
Well, we're about 5-2 on all the voting anyway. I'm just thinking for a bylaw to change because we were so concerned about reverting back to the bylaw change.
When that other bylaw was changed, how many voted for it?
Four.
I don't know that.
Four at a special meeting, at a special board meeting.
Okay, but here's my point, who did that hurt?
It doesn't matter, we weren't all there.
They changed the bylaws, that's the point here. They're talking about changing the bylaws, so the law, the rules should be for any kind of the bylaws.
Great, but okay, thank you.
You went through it with a fine tooth comb.
Well, I tried, I'm sure there's still more to boost to judge by the minutes, but.
Okay, so are we at the unfinished business? Unfinished business number 12.
I know that we adopt this policy. It's for patrons to create a studio. I have a question now. I looked over, it looks pretty well written, it's just one where you have draft from.
I had the same question.
Well, we, the one that I passed to you last month is part of this, and then Dennis's firm added several points to it, and then I took it back and.
It was a collection of talent.
Yes, and then I went back and consolidated it all a little bit.
The only issue I have is the studio's open to Niles Public District cardholders. Maybe times when a cardholder may want to bring somebody along.
Oh, definitely. Yes, it's just that somebody with a card has to be the one to book the room, but you can bring people with you, certainly. Yes.
The idea is somebody's got to be responsible.
Yes.
Get tied to the cardholder.
Sure.
Okay.
Right, so my question, because when I was reading through that, because that person would be responsible for any damage, so you could bill that person. So is there then a person who's on staff then that will go in there and then check to make sure that everything?
Yes, absolutely. But most of it's actually getting checked out to the person. They're going to be, that's what Victoria's been cataloging, which has taken her a lot of time, so that we'll have very accurate use and we'll know exactly who's got what, and then we'll get checked back in, and so it hopefully will be, you know, pretty strict.
I did have one question regarding whether people might read this and say, well, the first sentence says it's open to public cardholders and students attending school in the library district, but then when you get down to three or two, it says it's open to cardholders. So I don't know if that might cause some problems when you have individuals come in and say, look, I'm a member, I'm a student attending the school in the library district.
Yeah, I think it is a little fuzzy, and it's partly because Donna, the person that gave the demo down there, she is our high school liaison, so she'll be going into the high schools and she'll be promoting the use of this and explaining what we have. Some of those students will be our cardholders, some of them will not. So in the past, when we've been promoting something in a school, we have allowed the people, anybody at that school to go ahead and use it. They would have to have some library card that they could be checking things out onto. So we still would have to have track of our stuff. So, but the idea is not to be promoting something at the school that, to go that, well, you can use it, but I'm sorry, you can't. You don't want to be putting people in that position.
So like with the GoPro?
Correct.
Only the Niles cardholders can check that out? Yes, that one I'm getting, okay.
If you don't want to make that exception, that is up to you, and we can take it out, but that's, we want that loophole for those students.
And then, I just had one other question with the fair use policy and the copyright law. I know that they're going to be signing something, and they're going to have paperwork within a file. Is there any way to maybe post that somewhere again?
Oh, I think we'll definitely need to do that, yes.
Okay, because I think that's really important, because you know what, how many people actually read it? But I think it'd be really important if that was posted, especially if they bring someone else with them, just as a reminder, copyright, you know.
Yeah, that's a very good idea.
Okay. Okay, so, do we go on to take a roll? Is there any more discussion?
Where do we go to then?
The motion is on the table to pass the policy for the rules of patron use for the creative studio.
Okay.
Oh, nobody seconded.
I did.
Oh, yeah, you seconded.
Thank you very much.
Jeanette, you seconded?
Karen, do not. Okay, please take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yeah.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Jim?
Yes.
Okay, a motion to approve the recommended expenditure of $13,500 with Simplex Grinnell for the installation of the ADA compliant cinch notification appliances, which are the strobes, and related equipment throughout the library building.
So moved.
Second.
Karen, Barb? Any discussion?
Who are these faulty?
Yeah, what the ADA requirement is that...
I'm sorry, ADA.
American Disabilities Act. It requires all of the strobes within sight of a person at different points throughout the library to flash in the same rhythm. If they flash at different rhythms, it's possible to trigger some sort of seizure.
I was going to say, okay. Seizures, because yeah. I've heard of that at school.
So, so we have a number that don't flash at the same time, at the same rhythm. We approached this about a year ago. The solution that they came up with was roughly double. This $13,500, they wanted to replace more of the guts of the system, and we considered bids from a number of other providers, which verified that if they were to come in, for example, and help us out with this issue, they would have to replace a lot of the guts of the system, as well as the strobes themselves. If we stay with Simplex Grinnell, who is our current provider, they found a way to make the current equipment work and just install the appliances so that they do all sync together, or they all do flash together, and are synchronized.
So not to belabor the point, so you're concerned that we're not approving expenditures. Would you be...
With Simplex Grinnell?
Well, expenditures in general for the library. Would you be more amenable to that?
I'm confused. Expenditures, I don't know.
Libraries.
Did you say you were concerned about that?
That we don't approve, oh, the way we are passing,
right,
our budget,
right,
passes.
Right. But you had said you feel that the trustees are not approving, not spending money.
Oh, we're not part of the equation on many fronts, and we're taking even more accountability away from us. So I don't know what your question is.
Well,
what are you asking?
To it.
Okay.
In this like this particular issue, where we're asked to approve this $13,500, would you rather we saw the bids?
No, not at all. I'm thinking of much larger scale. Past couple years, salaries and benefits were a big deal, and a lot of, and just our budget, our entire budget, not just 13
right.
grand, our budget's 6 mil. I'm concerned
okay.
about a lot more.
All right, so
thank you.
As a board, we don't generally look at the bids to verify them or anything.
well, what I have here is first page
of the bid. I had Dave go back and formalize it so it reflects what's, you know, what's actually here. Generally speaking, for amounts of work, $5,000 or more, you get multiple bids. The challenge here is that only Simplex Grinnell services Simplex Grinnell.
It's a single source.
So we don't have much of a choice. We did, as I said, consider other vendors who wanted to come in and, you know, replace this panel, rip this panel out, et cetera. And their bids were all, you know, in excess of $20,000 to do the work. So the best way to do it, we feel, is to stay with Simplex Grinnell and spend a lesser amount, and then we'll be able to satisfy the ADA requirements and get occupancy certificates from the village mails.
How long is that going to take, do you think? I mean, is it like next month or is it next week?
Yeah, I mean, it's you know, it's once we tell them to go, you know.
Relatively short.
Yeah.
Just one. At this point, focus now.
Yeah, well, that's another thing. Inspectors are a little bit different. I do want to mention that that these funds will be coming out of the capital projects / special reserve fund, and it was one of the items that we had listed in the spreadsheet that we presented to the board, and the board approved last fall.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any further discussion? Okay, we can just take a vote.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yep.
Barbara?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, the next one, we've done discussion of 2015-16 budget. Christine, sorry?
That's me. All right, as all of you know, I was the sole no vote last month on this budget. And it's been bothering me that we just passed this budget. So I've been working on definition of fiduciary responsibility, as some of the residents brought up last month. And definitions are government employees, elected officials, appointed, hired, or contracted, are legally obligated to undivided loyalty to the people. One reason that government ethics is described in terms of obligations is that government officials have a fiduciary duty or obligation toward the community for which they serve and also the people who elected them. This economy is not the best. Not everyone makes a six-figure income. There are families that have both spouses working because it's necessary and they still struggle. We have a lot of seniors on fixed incomes and can't afford their taxes to increase. Budgets are a complicated matter and deserve to be reviewed, scrutinized, and questioned. We must act responsibly to the taxpayers and be loyal, as they are the ones that elected us. Right now, I feel the ones that voted to pass a near $1 million increase in the budget is acting irresponsibly. At our last board meeting held August 19th, when I asked if the budget was being passed tonight, I was told yes. I further went on to say, you're letting it stand as is with no discussion. I was told we're discussing it now. How can you discuss an almost $1 million increased budget in 5 minutes? I would like to ask each of you, if you were asked to contribute out of your pocket the increased budget amount, would you? I will bet each of you would say no, but it's okay to use taxpayers' money. I have never heard of budgets being created, whether in government and or private corporations, that are not being reviewed and cuts made, with the exception of school districts, as that is what skyrockets every year on my tax bill. In prior years, we held special meetings to review the budget, reviewing it line by line, and making cuts where necessary. I know there were some people that were upset that certain lines were cut, but the library did not close and programs went on. I did not hear complaints from residents that programs were unorganized due to lack of resources. I read an article in the Journal, written by Tom, posted online August 21st, where Mr. Pritz stated that the 2014 property tax levy was frozen, matching the 2013 tax. If the levy is increased, it could increase revenue, but this cannot be a deficit spending budget. The prior board lowered the levy, giving the taxpayers some relief on their tax bills, which made them very happy. If the levy is increased, we will be putting the taxes back where they originally were. Had the budget been discussed and cuts made where necessary, Mr. Pritz probably would not have even brought up the levy because it would not have been a concern. In saying and bringing this to your attention, I have questions on line items within this budget. So, what I want, and I only pulled a few lines, so I'm just, can you tell me what's professional collection?
Professional collection are the software and books that are library-oriented. So, for example, the catalogers might have a new manual, and that would be purchased out of that money, and probably multiple copies for the different catalogers.
Okay. Well, I know last year we spent $7,692. This year's budget, $750.
Right. So there was there was something in particular that we bought last year that we don't need to buy this year, so it was reduced.
Okay, well, I don't know because we didn't review it.
But we did put it on the agenda June 1st, July, and August, so you could have asked any of those questions.
But we didn't go line by line or make any cuts.
But when we did go line by line last year, enough, it was passed like that without going through line by line.
We did go line by line.
I don't think you were there.
I was there.
I don't think so.
Okay.
Promo expense is going up 113%. Professional development 138%. There are things going down, I'm not going to say. Pressing supplies is going down almost 12.5%. Kitchen supplies down 13.5%. So I am saying things are going down. But the program and support joint going up 264%.
Well, I mean, that's a smaller amount of money than the others have anyway. That is because we now have this gallery space up here, and there are some particular display programs that we want to bring in, an exhibit, and then programs to go along with the exhibit, and then we have all of the things going along with the new spaces. So, for example, some of the things that are coming up this weekend, that would be the kind of thing that's, it's a library-wide thing instead of particularly for one audience or another. And my understanding was that, you know, I heard from several of the trustees when they were campaigning that they wanted to have more programs and more materials. So that is why we raised those particular
And
lines.
We did hear that from the community.
Well, within your budget, I mean, we could do a lot of things.
But that is what the community wanted, and that's why
we were voted in, yes. Well,
not at the expense of increasing
the levy. Well, we scared them, letting them think the library was falling apart.
The
levy's
going to have to be increased on those items that we have exhausted. It's not because of the program or the budget.
If your budget's going up and you can't cover your expenses, where does the money come from?
It's actually completely separate. What's because separate? Those are the special revenues. That is...
I'm talking about the general budget.
Right. But
it's gone up.
But we would have to levy is actually the revenues.
Now, wasn't the revenue just a few hundred thousand? Don't we ascertain that? Social Security, what are we talking about? Just a small number.
That's what we're talking about.
Did you have more questions?
Go ahead.
Okay, I understand we want raises 2.4 to 3. So now I'm confused because I just plugged in looking at last year's salary for, I did the line, so department manager, super librarian, 156. Now, and I'm not coming up anywhere here, so I don't know if I made it wrong for me or whatever, but I did director because there was only one. So I put in 115 for last year. And this budget, the budget is 122.4, which is 6.44%.
That's the salary you gave me. You hired me at 122.
I thought it was 115.
No.
That was Linda's salary.
But she didn't get a raise, and she did not get a raise.
Right, no, I know that. Okay, I thought we gave her 115.
No.
All right. Then, library.
So we're asking.
No.
Right.
We just said no.
She was here, we discussed it.
Okay, so apparently she didn't remember, so she's asking, let's not get in attack mode, please.
I'm in attack mode.
All right. Librarian one, 1.113. This year, 1.165, 4.63% increase.
Well, you recall that last year we were under a hiring freeze. So we had positions that were not being hired, and now this year we're not in a hiring freeze and we're hiring again to staff to the levels that we need to cover the desks that we have and the programs that we have.
So this is actually for additional, because my next one is going to be grade five at 594 last year to 658, which comes to 10 and 3.
Yeah, that's the biggest one, because we are trying to have more work be done by paraprofessionals instead of by the professionals, which was a board request.
No, the biggest increase is department manager, 66.79 is the biggest.
Well, because we didn't.
Didn't we lose a lot of them before the freeze or during the freeze?
Yeah, we have had positions open.
That's what,
okay, yeah.
That we have been, okay.
Right.
And then there was, I know when Carolyn had brought up, where you said the budget did not go up that much, so I have last year's here. And I can, when you mention it, so I don't know what I'm missing, but when I looked at library expenditures, June 30th, it was 5 mil. This year's budget is 6.4.
So last year's budget was 6,429,497. This year's budget is 6,498,076, which is an increase of 68,579. If you want to compare it to last year's actual expenses, last year's actual expenses were 5,638,236, which is an $859,000 increase. However, $400,000 of that increase is in the special reserve fund, and actually last year we had planned to spend $527,000 of the special reserve fund monies, but only ended up spending $94,921. So this year we budgeted $497,000, and again, that's special reserve or capital projects money, which has no revenue, which money was put aside last year. We transferred, or the library board transferred $1.2 million to bring the funding level up to $1.8 million. And we have plans to spend in the budget $497,000. The building and site fund, which is also a special revenue fund, we budgeted $209,000 last year, only spent $95,000. This year we budgeted $210,000. So exactly $1,335 increase from budget to budget, but $115,037 increase budget to last year's actual. The building and site fund is intended to cover contingencies that may come up where we need to fix something in a hurry or fix something that we didn't expect to fix. Okay, so the nature of those monies is that you typically budget more, hopefully you spend less because you're not in emergency mode, but you do spend a fair amount in there.
Right.
The balance of the 859, or roughly $359,000, is in the general fund. Okay, when you compare this year's budget to last year's actual,
right.
It's in three main areas. It's in personnel.
Right.
It's in materials, and it's in programming. So salaries, including the $75,000, and fringe benefits went up a total of $380,000, approximately, okay? The exact figures are salaries, $280,650, and fringe benefits, $95,400, okay? Materials went up $112,497, budget to actual, but $129,500, budget to budget. Okay, so we were a little bit over budget last year in materials. And I don't have an exact number for, I don't have an exact number for programming, but I believe programming went up approximately $30,000. All of these are offset partially by the fact that we don't have a retirement incentive plan that the board voted for last year, which cost us roughly, or exactly, $201,643.
You're talking the 457B?
No, the retirement incentive plan.
All of that, the buyout.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So when you net all of that together, the increase in the general fund is roughly $359,000. Okay. Of the 859, 500 of it, approximately, is outside of the general operating fund.
And then I just have one question. You mentioned.
And I, And these are the exact things that we talked about on at the June meeting, as well as the July meeting, and in full or in part at the August meeting, as we talked about the differences between last year and this year.
Can I just ask a quick question? The 256, which I, or something to that, close to that number you mentioned, was the, what did we call it, the, what's the correct term? Is it a buyout or what, I don't know what we call it.
Incentive plan.
It was 201,643.
201,000. Did we not expect to, I thought the purpose of that was because most of those positions were going to save us money. We were supposed to save at least $100,000 from the IT position. Did we not assume any savings with the other positions, or did you plan on just replacing them? I thought it was all about saving in the future.
Well, it was a couple of different reasons. Saving, certainly one of them. If you recall, our director retired, and we can't, I don't think we could have a library without a director, so we had to hire a new director.
You know, honestly, I don't think it needs to be placed that way. I'm asking you, I thought the purpose of the incentive plan was for us not to need to replace most of those positions.
Well, you tend to go back to the previous year, because last year it was budgeted with that in mind, as I recall.
So I'm just saying, from that original plan to for these, the opportunity for these people to leave the library, there was a dollar amount that we experienced that we would save because we would not replace those positions. So I'm trying to figure out if that ever, you know, ever.
I know that there's restructuring, I don't mean to jump in, but there's definitely, I mean, we went from two assistant directors just to one assistant director. So
well, I'm
right
talking
there.
Specifically about the incentives. I mean, yeah, that was something else.
Right, but the year I think it was part of all the restructuring.
The year before last, we spent approximately $3.4 million on the salary line item. Last year, we budgeted $3,141,000, roughly $300,000 or so less. We ended up spending $2,906,000. This year, we budgeted $3,186,862, which is about $45,000 more than what we budgeted last year, but $280,000 more than what we actually spent.
So my question again is, do we plan on saving any of the positions? I mean, we need to get back into IT. I mean, do we need to eventually hire someone there as well?
Well,
I have that as part of the discussion that you have brought up later on the agenda for the discussion of media lab staffing. I have org charts going back several times, so we can discuss that.
Okay. Just, it was always in the back of my mind, because I know every month you mentioned how we had, we were below staffing. And I always wondered how much of that amount did we plan to really use for new positions? I just thought there was some part of it that we didn't plan.
So 2 years ago, we spent about $3.4 million, and then we were about $300,000 less as a result of the retirement incentive plan.
Okay, that was okay.
So we can discuss the other piece in the next, it's already 9:30, so. Discussion of board meeting procedures. Minutes and video recordings?
Yes, I'd like to find out how we go about creating our minutes. I know there's a little tape recorder here, and then I take it, you transcribe them?
I listen to them.
And,
I'm trying to paraphrase, you know, the important points.
Totally, I understand. What I would like to suggest is that once the minutes are ready, that the board members, since we're present, could see these minutes and send you either changes or additions before we get here. It'd give us some time to review it. It's not that easy sitting around this table trying to remember everything that's transpired a month before. And there seems to be inaccuracies based on the fact that one person can't possibly understand what everyone was thinking or saying or however, but I think we should have an opportunity to see them before they end up in the next month's budget, or I think you do them once a month. So we can send you our input, and then by today, for this meeting, they would have been revised. And whatever she saw and whatever I wanted to add would already have been done. But it gives us an opportunity to view them, and I would think we should be able to do that.
Well, I think we do obviously have a chance to review them. They're sent out to us ahead of time, which also
on Friday before. That's not enough.
Well, that's, I mean, she doesn't get them done a lot before that.
So they're not done until the Friday before the next board meeting?
Well, not the Friday, but she works on them a little, but she has a lot of other things that she does.
So when are the minutes ready?
So, like you said, so we do get them ahead of time.
When do we get them? Wait, let's clarify. When do we get, when can I see the minutes ahead of time?
Well, just Friday, Friday afternoon is when you can see the minutes. From my point of view, unless the board agrees. The problem with what you're suggesting in my mind is if it goes out to all of you and Karen makes a suggestion and you make a suggestion and you make a suggestion and some of your suggestions are conflicting and you're not all at the table at the same time,
that's hard to use a Google shared document. I mean, this is done.
It is not up to you to write the minutes. Technically, it's Barbara Nakanishi's responsibility to write the minutes. And traditionally, it has been delegated to the board secretary.
Okay, I'm just asking.
If you want to write the minutes, you have to apply for the job, a job at the library.
But I think that what we do right now sort of makes sense because we can all hear what other people's suggestions are. And I do think there's a problem that we would have, we would be sending conflicting changes to Diane.
Oh, I would only submit mine, and you would only submit yours.
Yeah, but they may conflict.
Right.
With each other. With what's on the table.
With each other. I may be making, so I think it's best that we discuss them while we're all here to determine if we agree that those are appropriate changes.
Because he has always worked.
Yeah.
And we always table it if any changes need to be done, just like
as
this
we did,
evening.
We did tonight, right? Now, I know you have some changes, proposed changes that are perhaps more than typos, which, you know, I think we can handle pretty easily just going through the typos.
For the most part, I think Diane's done a good job.
I'm not saying she doesn't do a good job. I'm saying there's a better way for us to be able to review them in advance and provide our information. You're saying there isn't? Fine.
I've said it on a lot of different boards.
So have I. I've never received minutes when I came to a meeting. They're always circulated in advance.
Ours are circulated in advance.
We do get minutes. I mean, I read them over. I have to admit, I didn't write them as thoroughly as
no,
I did.
You had time to be able to do it. Shame dust.
I did have them ahead of time, and, well, they are available to us.
Well, maybe that's the point. When they're available to us doesn't allow us to be able to read them in detail as she did.
So you would like to have the minutes earlier? I would be willing to. Work with Diane to get the minutes to you earlier, but I just wouldn't want to make changes without the rest of the people here.
That's fine, but at least then I can come here prepared and say, I'd like this edit.
So how far in advance do you feel like you need?
I don't know, but Friday or Saturday morning in my mailbox just didn't cut it.
Well, they are online.
They're online, and the link is...
When are they online?
I'm sure it's online.
Well, that's not, I'm at work, and by the time I get home, it's still Saturday morning. I didn't know that they were...
Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. It's still 6 days, it's pretty far in advance.
I'm work all day, no, it's...
So do we all.
I know, but no one has the time to scrutinize these like she did. And I've only been halfway through them.
Thank goodness Jeanette's on our board, because she got them. That's why there's seven of us.
I don't open my pack.
You're very good.
I open my pack and before I get here.
So do I.
You got them.
Yeah.
I imagine that Diane would be perfectly fine with getting them to you.
Whenever you want them, I'll do them.
Well, I don't want you to commit to having to put that as the top priority, but...
Okay, so that would be Thursday.
A chance would be...
Can we have it tomorrow then?
It's asking for an extra day.
It's a whole day, if you don't have it anyway.
I mean, it's one day, so you're talking Thursday instead of Friday.
It's 1 week, that's right.
No.
A week earlier.
Diane will try to get the, sent out to the board, or she'll give them to me, and I will send them out to the board.
Or you can email them, or wherever, as long as they're available somewhere.
So you would like them 1 week prior, the Wednesday before, instead of the Friday, the Wednesday?
Wednesday, okay.
Well, since we're talking about...
No, I meant a week before the Friday, that's not good enough.
It's 2 weeks before.
I'm not getting Diane on.
So Wednesday, 1 week prior to the actual board meeting.
And then I can get them online, what you say?
Yeah, well, I post them on Friday before the board meeting.
Oh.
Once the packet is done, then it's posted.
Oh, okay.
I mean, the bylaws call for the information to get to you by Saturday morning, so she's actually getting them to you by Friday and hand delivering them by maintenance.
Minutes or the agenda?
The whole packet comes to you the Friday instead of the Saturday, so we already have a deadline. But if you need a couple more days, certainly she could get them done by the Wednesday. We swear every month that we're gonna get them done by the year anyway, so...
See, that is our goal.
It is our goal, so we can certainly try to do that.
Like a plan.
Okay, Wednesday.
Well, since we're talking about the...
Yes.
I have, and I wasn't gonna bring it up, but since we're talking about them, in my opinion, the detail of the public comments is too much. In my opinion, you can simply state, Mr. Sapansky commented on the budget and the tax income. Ms. Ryan kind of said, Mr. Caravota commented about the IMRF. I don't think we need to have as verbatim, and I don't think we're nearly required at all in any form to have as verbatim information of the public comments. I think it's just, Mr. Spadoni got up and commented about this issue.
So this is where I get confused. I don't know how much detail I need to put in this.
Okay, I don't think it's good hard to do.
It's really hard to do, but there's, it's just a summary. So-and-so got up and commented. It doesn't have to be exactly what they said, that it should be different lettering, and it shouldn't be this, it shouldn't say that, or it should, you know, whatever. They just commented about the water pump.
Right,
you know, you can do that, but you know what? Are we not serving the public?
Well, no, that's not the point.
Well, but we videotape these meetings.
They kind of highlighted their opinion rather than what we actually talked about in the whole meeting. For me, when I wrote up the minutes, and it was mainly what their information was, it highlighted that was the main focus over the whole meeting.
Too much weight on that one.
Which it should be brief, just like we talk about all the different pieces, it would be the same thing.
I think abbreviated summaries are appropriate, particularly now that the whole meeting is videotaped.
Exactly.
So anyone who looks at those minutes and says, you know, geez, I really want to know exactly what Mr. Sapansky said, they can go, they can watch it, they can listen to exactly what that person said.
I don't think we can provide minutes in one format and videotaping in another. There has to be some similarity. They can't be completely different, and both of them acceptable.
They're not completely different.
Well, if these are so concise.
That's never going
to
be.
Can I?
I just think the public is entitled to have what they said.
Well, the public's getting it.
Okay, that would be the second.
Okay. I've been keeping my mouth shut. One of the things, my concern with this is,
right now. We're almost 3 hours into this meeting. How big is this packet going to be if they give us such a detailed minutes that you're asking to me, the way I'm understanding what you're asking
for? Well, some information is probably more important than others. I'm not saying everything has to be there. I'm just saying some things were missing. I'm saying if taxpayers come here and have the floor, we should at least write what they said. And they made some very valid points. It's the only reason they came. I mean, if you want to write...
It's still opinion, and it's theirs, and we listen, and we should put down the general topic, I believe, and then...
You could say whether they agreed or disagreed about the topic.
It wouldn't even be the agree or disagree. It would just be a state what their basic information...
Basic concern was.
Mm-hmm. Detail.
Do you have any guidance for us, Dennis?
It's a fair summary of what I've heard at the meeting, so there's no bright line test, of course, and it's always a challenge as to how much you include and how much you leave out. If you're asking my opinion about it, I think it's accurate. If you have the topic of what a public person says at the open meeting, part of the public time, a part of the meeting, I agree that you don't have to have a verbatim statement of what he said, what he said, as long as you have a clear summary of what their point was.
And their position.
Correct.
Maybe, yeah. So the topic and then a clear position of that topic. So we're not misrepresenting them. That would make sense.
Mm-hmm.
And then if anybody wanted to look at it further, we have the videotape for them to look at it in the back.
Mm-hmm.
And that's acceptable then? I mean, because we have the video, there doesn't need to be a...
And now that we're... That's 100% transparent.
Well, I think even if we didn't have the video, what he was saying would still be true.
The video certainly helps. The fact that they can go to the video and listen to the entire public comment helps tremendously, for sure. But even without it, I think a fair summary of what they said without the details is sufficient.
Topic and clear position.
Linda, are we going to put it in writing so we get it right? I just don't remember what you said, but if you just
it's going to cost more money.
Oh, he's in here so much, don't sweat it. I mean, what's one more sentence?
You'd be surprised.
Right, the next item is video recording.
Yes, but we skipped over under new business discussion of the use of the library for conducting business.
Oh, so sorry, we sure did.
Where
did
it go? You are right.
A1. Yeah, 11.
Yeah. Should we go back to that?
Sure.
Okay, I'm so sorry.
I think I was confused with the A and the 1.
Yeah. So in the rules, and so that is all the way at the beginning of this, the rule that covers this says, no portion of the library premises shall be used as a place of and or for the conduct of private for-profit activities, enterprise, and or business. Exceptions to this policy are subject to board approval. So you had a letter from a patron who had noticed that we have a patron who regularly appears to be doing business in the library. He has a little printer fax machine that he sets up on the table, and he's got his laptop, and she said, is that appropriate for the library? And so according to this policy, nobody should be doing business in the library, but we do now know that many people are using the library for business.
Not with library clients, you're getting meetings with them.
And many people do. That's a lot of what the study rooms are being used for. My question to you is, we built this new building, we built all the studying rooms in it, the meeting rooms, we've reached out to the chamber, we have told our business community that we really want to support the work that they're doing. We have very many patrons who have many multiple electronics plugged in that you just walk through, and it's the phone, it's the tablet, it's the laptop, it's the everything plugged in. His is just a little bigger, so it's more noticeable, but he doesn't in any other way he's not distracting in any way. He's not a disturbance in any way. That would be a question for the board to decide whether they want to change that library rule so that people can use the library for business, or if you want to continue with that rule, in which case we have to start,
not a lot of people listen to contracts and.
Maybe we should add the word primary, like their primary place of business.
Is he camped out here every day?
But if there's a practical aspect, how do you?
Yeah, you prove that.
How do you prove it?
Yeah, how do you?
Please.
I mean, we have the, who's it called when you stamp things?
Notarize.
Notary, we have many of the pieces that help and assist.
There's a real issue on the last part of that, whereas exceptions to the policy are subject to board approval without having any criteria of how the board's going to make a decision as to whether a business is okay and the other business isn't. So based on content, and you've got a real problem.
Yeah.
Sure.
So that sort of broad discretion is problematic in a big way.
And, you know, I don't, it doesn't bother me so much if someone's doing some business while they're here, but it would concern me if they are monopolizing, you know, an area so much constantly during the day that other patrons don't have a chance to use it, or it's hard for them to get a computer. And that I'm concerned about, so I don't know if we can address it in some way as to the amount of time they're using it, or.
It doesn't sound like they're using a computer. It sounds like they're using their own computer, so maybe they're using a tiny bit of bandwidth.
They're using a table, I mean, he typically goes to the same table, but that's true of most of our patrons. People always have their beeline for the table that they like. So it would be awfully hard to distinguish who's doing what at which table. So my recommendation to the board would be next month to strike this. But that is a board decision, so.
So you're recommending that paragraph six be stricken.
The second.
Second six.
The second six.
Second six.
The second six.
Yes, sorry, I didn't bother fixing the numbers.
Right.
So we're allowing people to come here and they can work on their business.
Yeah, because many people work from home now, and so a lot of them just, they get tired of being at home, so they come to the library for a while. And we have, you know, reached out to the business community that I want to support them. So I was taken aback when she said that, although I will say that also, it gave me pause when I saw the guy with his printer, because it's kind of like, huh.
I was going to ask.
This is odd.
But I have asked the staff, and they say that it doesn't create a disturbance, it almost never is used, he just is bringing it, and.
Right, because I know that, I was saying, my husband does the same thing, he brings his printer fit everywhere.
So for this patron's.
I know.
Comment.
I know.
What we're going to do is change the bylaws.
It's okay.
So I would bring this to you next month as a, for you to vote on, okay? So I.
If you want to control it, find another way other than the content of what they're doing.
Thanks, Barb, for bringing it up.
Thank you very much. Okay, now we're, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Video recordings.
Video recordings.
I thought we were done with that, Marie.
No, video recordings. Yes, I watched only one of the videos. And what I noticed was in the, while we're having our meeting, the entire room isn't always focused. Sometimes it moves to the side, or then we zero in on who's speaking. And I understand it's important to make sure you see who's speaking, but I'm thinking if we're videotaping, it should be permanent, and it should constantly be able to pick up the entire room. Sometimes also patrons sitting in those chairs can't be viewed, and I think we'd like to see who's saying what, and actually I think the entire board should be exposed at the same time. It looks like we're selecting what we're viewing, and I don't know how that happens, because I thought it was stationary and it just records. So I was wondering, is that not wide enough to pick up the entire room, and then we just alter it or something later?
Is that a question for you?
Yeah, I have a question for you.
I mean, I don't know.
This is as wide as we can go. That's why I pushed it as back as I can.
Mm-hmm.
We've only recorded maybe a handful of meetings, and I'm assuming what you're referring to is the last one, which is the only time that I remember that there was ever public comment on video, so we wanted to kind of hone in to make sure whoever was speaking that we can see their face while they're making their comment.
Well, was that right in the camera though?
It just, I just pressed record. Oh, you meant last time. I was.
Oh,
remember seeing you.
And then my point was, the village just records the entire meeting, which means then it's totally transparent, nobody's changing or manipulating anything. I'd like to know if, I don't know if you have to raise it or what, but can't we just record the entire room all at once? And then everything that's happening, you can observe.
Would that have something to do with the size of the room, though? Because like he's saying, he's pushing it as far back as he can. The village hall where they have the meetings, that's a pretty wide room.
And mainly, we're just speaking, so we wouldn't really need to have that unless there was public comment.
Well, I'm saying the room needs to, well, you could, you'd have all the people sitting there, you don't even know they're here.
It's okay, they're signed in, and we have them, well, right, we have
it's in the minutes.
Well, I doubt if it's wide enough to catch these chairs right here.
Oh, and we didn't plan to have, I mean, if there are people who can't even see us.
No, it's just for us.
Well, I think it's also for public comment.
Well, public comment.
Maybe we should have the public comment, then somebody stand up.
Well, actually, we were talking about that. We were thinking of having maybe a podium up here for public comment, so that it would be right here in our view. We were discussing maybe having one here or here, so then, and then I just won't, I'll just turn.
Sure.
And that way everyone can see, and that way they would be in plain view, and then we would be able to set the timer, they'd have their paper. It would be a little more like the Niles.
Well, it would be consistent, is what I was saying.
Yeah.
That's all I meant.
Actually, we did have that discussion, so that would actually work.
That makes sense.
Yeah, we can do that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think the village has spent a lot of money on their setup because they, because it's being broadcast.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were, because of last week, we did have a discussion on that.
And it was the only one I looked at.
Right, and I think that would work because then we could call the person, we have the sign in, while we have the sheets to explain our policy. We'll have them right here.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, that's great, thank you. Okay, discussion of the media lab staffing.
I'm passing out the org charts going back for the last 3 years because I thought it would be good just to make it clear that we have been working on tightening up our structure considerably. So this top one is December 2014, I believe it is, so during the construction project. And at that time, if you look at the upper management of it, all of the purple boxes, the blue boxes, and the box for the director that is circled in pink, altogether there were 13 people in upper management at that time. So then the second sheet shows the arrangement when I was interim director, and we had reduced the number of people at the top level at that time.
What month year would that be approximately?
Well, it would be the whole last year. So, you know, basically July through May 20th when you put me in place. And then the final sheet is what I am planning to do, what I'm putting into place right now. The final sheet has my boxes turned to green. The green lines show the people that report to me. The black lines show people that report to Greg, and we have added on Cindy Rademacher as our assistant director to handle project management. And by the way, Cindy has done a spectacular job on getting all of the creative studio all set up and ready to go. She's been invaluable. So anyway, if you count the boxes here, you will see that we have reduced the upper management from 13 to 10. So we have been combining department heads, we have been combining departments, we have been trying to get this organization down to a much leaner meter. This is not the final chart because we don't have our report back from the IT company. So this is not absolutely final, so I would really prefer this not go into other hands. Yes, ma'am.
Susan, I have a question. The second sheet on the left-hand side, interim assistant director, weren't you the interim director?
Yes, but I was also the assistant director. So.
Oh, well, so you should put interim and assistant director.
Yeah, I could have done that. Yeah. But I mean, that's just how
it is.
It's
fine. Okay.
Yes. Thank you.
But you were the director, not
yes, madam.
Okay.
Yes, I was. I was just wearing a lot of hats that year. So anyway, I just wanted to make the point that we have now added this digital services department, which you see is in my chain of command, and we have now hired a supervisor for that department. But it's not an increase in supervisor positions. We're actually still, you know, we have reduced in the last year and a half from 13 to 10 upper management positions. So that's just the basis for this. Now I will pass out the job descriptions that Carolyn requested to go along to describe what the different, I assume when you said media, digital media lab, you're talking about digital services.
The new, yes, that's what I need, clarification.
Sure.
Media Land, Digital Services.
Digital Services is the new department that is put in place to basically manage the technology floor, which is where you had your tour. It covers the creative studio, Studio A and Studio B. It covers the tech desk, all the people that are managing the computers in the middle of the room. They'll also be managing the study rooms, but that's not as much.
That's Digital Services.
That is Digital Services. Digital Services will be in charge of staff training and putting on all the technology programs. They will be, the person that currently works in adult services will be moving, and she's the person that organizes all of the online resources, like ebooks and databases. So those things are moving down to Digital Services. All of the training programs, that librarian is moving down to Digital Services. So in your packet, you see that we have the Digital Services Supervisor, you have the Digital Services Librarian, and we have agreed that she will be an Assistant Department Head because she has been the one that ran the task force together with Donna Blanc, this is Darlene Fox. So she will be the Assistant Department Head. She will be attending the Management Boot Camp next week.
So is she, is she above the supervisor?
No, 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 she's the supervisor's assistant. So she will be, she's still going to be the person that's in charge of the ebook committee and is in charge of the databases and keeping the statistics on all those.
Database for the whole library.
Okay. You know, with input from the other staff. It's not all her decision. She, in all of these things, is consulting with other people. Mm-hmm. But she's talking to vendors and she's getting information. The next sheet is the training librarian. That's the one that does the technology classes. That's Ruth, if you've met her. She's done a ton of technology programs over the years, so she will be moving to that department and continuing to do those classes. Both of those two librarians will continue to work on the reference desk from time to time to keep up those skills. The next one is the grade 5 position of Digital Services Assistant. We have assistant people, that's a paraprofessional position, so those people are going to be manning the tech desk and doing programs and helping people with their setups in Studio A and working in Studio B, you know, with like the 3D printer and things like that.
And these are the 6 positions, or 3, that you're thinking of needing?
No, well, I mean, yes, I guess so. The positions, if we feel like we need to bulk up, it will be on that grade level. So
are
it will
these,
be with this.
Are these current positions, or these are the positions you're thinking of?
These are the positions.
Creating.
Yeah, well, I mean, these are the positions I'm moving people into. Yeah.
Okay, so right now, this, am I looking at the right thing, Digital Services, the last page,
yeah,
what we have now?
This is what, well, you know, I haven't officially moved anybody. I haven't sent out letters saying your new position is in Digital Services. I'm giving you
so
basically
in
this
there right now. You're creating it, right? You're creating this.
I have hired a supervisor. She starts on October 5th.
For,
pardon me?
Susie Wolf.
And then we have the two people I am moving out of Adult Services into Digital Services.
Which would be these two librarians.
The two librarians. We have two more people that also are part of Adult Services that will be moving into Digital Services. We have one person who is taking, I had a 20-hour position in Adult Services that was open. I am going to put that in Adult Services, in Digital Services, and that's Sergeant Masilic because he's put on the task force. He's done. You'll be seeing him in Smashbox. He's done a great deal with it. He's Sasha's brother.
Oh. Okay.
And he's one of the patron services team leaders. Okay. You've probably seen him down there. And we'll be moving at least one of the IT assistants down there because there will be an IT component to this department. And that is the next job description, is the IT, Digital Services IT assistant. And that's also grade 5. And it may be that if I have to hire, it may be more on the IT side, or it may be more on the assistant side, and I'm not sure. But that's why I wanted to keep my options open.
Okay, so then now I understand that we hired a supervisor, and it's not because we weren't sure how many staff people we needed, but because you've also gotten libraries moved over, so we do have, I couldn't figure out what the dynamics of this department was. First of all, I was getting confused between Media Lab and Digital Services, and
sure,
is one a part of the other? And I just wanted some clarification. I did not hear that you were hiring a supervisor until I got the email. I'm like, wait a minute, I'm confused. I thought we don't even know who's going to be in the department. So now this is very clear.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Does anybody else have any questions or clarifications? Okay.
Okay, so we're in other.
So, just one question, when you're completely done, you'll give us a new one of these, right?
I can, if you'd like.
I really like this.
Yeah, it's nice.
Okay.
That way you'll have the status.
Okay.
Thank you for this.
Certainly. All right, for my other. According to Matrix, is this a good time? Okay, for other, I just have one thing to say. According to Matrix, it was very low with the percentage with the board and staff vision. If you remember, it was like 13% or 17%. It was very negative.
It was 13-something, yeah.
So I would like to just ask if maybe for November, for Thanksgiving coming up, maybe we can do a board, staff, kind of just a small gathering where they, you know, staff can talk with us and give them thanks for, you know, being an exemplary staff and where we can actually be together and meet people. They can get to know us a little bit. We can get to know them a little bit. Just have a, yes. So we can talk about it next time if you'd like to think it over, but I think it would be really great. I think it's a great time to have something. I was thinking of a barbecue, but it kind of got away from us. I was thinking we had a couple months ago, you know, and I was thinking, okay. Yeah, well, here we are in September, so that, okay. So I think it would be really great.
I think having November would be good. Yeah. December, sometimes it gets really crowded.
Right, so Thanksgiving is actually kind of nice and it's perfect, actually a perfect time for us too.
Yeah.
You know, send our thanks to the staff.
That would be in the evening, I presume.
I would, yeah. It would be in the evening.
Yeah.
I could see where any staff members would want to come in the evening.
Well, I would think if we did it around, you know, between, you know, the 4 to 7, something like that, where we have people who are leaving at 5 and then the part-timers that come later, that might, it might work. You know, something like that. And a day where obviously, you know, most of us can make it at least. I think that would be great.
That's great.
So.
Yeah, hopefully it would help our numbers.
Hopefully, I think I could work. So, but that would, I think that would really be a nice extension for us to at least get to know people too and get to learn any other concerns that maybe we can help out. Otherwise, we need motion to adjourn the meeting.
Well, wait a minute. I have something.
I'm sorry.
Don't we want to talk about the Night of the Roses?
Well, we did.
No, didn't we need to decide if the board wants to pay?
Oh, you're right. We did.
Okay, so do we find out if what the Niles?
They pay for village. The individual trustees.
They pay for
the trustees.
Trustees to go. Yes. Okay, so then, if we want, it was our discussion that we want to mirror what the village does.
We were going. We should. Yeah, we did discuss it.
Yeah. All, okay. But. Well, then why don't we discuss it?
I like that.
Did we want to mirror? Did we want to mirror? I think that's a really good idea if we mirror what the village does.
Can you tell us? I mean, I don't know what the village does.
Pay for?
Yeah.
Well, they pay for Night of the Roses. They pay for golf outing.
The chamber. Chamber golf outing?
Yes. And
then there's another chamber event usually, isn't there? No.
Christmas party.
The
chamber's Christmas party.
Oh, well, that I don't know, because the village Christmas party, I even have to pay if I don't
okay.
know.
Okay, all right. And, you don't think they pay for the chamber Christmas party, though? Is that what you're saying?
No, they don't. Because,
okay,
no.
All right, so the chamber golf.
Golf, Night of the Roses, and mayoral lunch.
During the day, so.
Yeah.
Susan, did you check?
I did check, and what Steve told me is that the trustees have a line on the budget for donations where they can also contribute to any organization that they want to support, so that they do want to support the chamber, so that's, I think, where that comes from.
Okay, so it sounds like Night of the Roses, Chamber of Health, and the mayoral luncheon. Do we want to stick with those three things?
What's the mayoral luncheon? I've never been on. What is that anyway?
It's the state of the building, exactly. Right. They used to have the development officer and people like that get up and speak. Right. Lately, it's been more just the mayor talking.
Now, how do we want to handle if anyone gets one of our employees, one of our staff members gets an award somewhere? Should we just do that on our own if we want to go?
No, I don't think so.
I mean, if we want to support them, maybe we can discuss that as it possibly comes up. Okay, all right. I think, you know, that might be something that we want to.
Well, it is October 17th.
Well, no, this one, yeah, but thank you. It's Night of the Roses.
It's Night of the Roses.
So, okay, that sounds it. That's perfect. So, all right. So as of right now, just let Diane know if you want to attend, and then you can give us the details. Okay? Anything else in other?
I'll be with the village.
Okay. So we need a motion to adjourn the meeting at 10:05.
Second.
Karen Gaddy, please take a roll.
Okay, Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Gaddy?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.